But you seem to have been kind of steamrolling yourself into a mess, right? Because this is how you come over in the book. But that is from alcohol as well, and you had to go into the Betty Ford Hospital, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
That was presumably...
Not hospital, it's the centre.
Right. Now, that was because of alcoholism rather than obesity?
It had nothing to do with obesity.
No.
It had totally to do with addiction, alcohol and pills.
Mm.
And they advise you when you're there not to stop smoking, not to try and give up caffeine, not to diet, not to even think about it.
Mm.
You're there for one reason,
mm.
and you concentrate on that 100%.
Mm.
And it's hard enough to get over that. You have to give it your all, and you go through a whole process of peeling layers of guck to get down to why did I become this mess.
Do you know why?
Oh, I learned there many things. I'm not going into them.
Mm.
Then when I cleaned my inside act up and I felt so wonderful and energetic and good about myself, that's when I decided that I was wearing the wrong slipcover and I wanted the exterior to match the interior.
Mm. You know, when you decided to go into Betty Ford, in your book, you imply that it was partly pressure from your family. Is that right?
And family intervention.
Yeah. What does that mean? Do you mean they actually said to you, you should do it?
They come and see you. It's called tough love. And they tell you things you've done, things they've seen, some of your behavior. And they preface it by saying, oh, I love you very much. But I have to tell you this, that. And the reason I'm telling you this is because I don't want you to die, and the way you're going, you will.
So kind of,
and
like...
it's astonishing. It's absolutely terrifying. And you listen, and it goes around the room. And finally I said to them, would you just leave me alone for a couple of hours? I have to make it my decision, because if it isn't my decision to go and do this, it won't last. It won't have any effect on me.
Did they come to see you then because of advice from, say, a doctor or something like that? I mean, did they do that on their own accord, or were they asked to do that?
No, they got together and just said, Mom's in trouble.
And then faced you with a lot of home truths.
Mm.
I mean, could you at that moment, with your addiction still strong, could you at that moment take it in and accept that they are probably telling you the truth about yourself?
Oh, I knew they were telling the truth.
Well, did you have a great character change, for instance?
Then and there?
Yes, no. But before, were you going through a very bad patch? Like, often alcohol...
Oh, I was
makes
at the bottom.
Yeah.
Everything that had started, and obesity was part of it. I was really in the pits.
Mm. But did you? I mean, when did you start to get into real danger with booze then? Because a lot of people drink and be merry, and nothing happens.
I have always been able to consume enormous amounts of booze and never get drunk.
Mm.
It would be when I'd go home and take my sleeping pills on top of the booze that I'd walk into walls,
mm.
and that's when my children would have to pick me up off of the floor and put me into bed. And when I'd hear things like that, I was appalled
mm.
and riddled with such awful guilt that I'd done that to my children.
Mm.
I was devastated.
When you then went into Betty Ford, that was voluntary, obviously.
Mm.
And then were you able to... Was it a group therapy you did?
Yes.
Yeah. It must have been very odd for people to do group therapy with you, because you're so famous. It can't be everybody famous there, can they?
I was the first celebrity ever to have done it.
Yeah.
Except Betty Ford, of course, who did it at the Naval Center in Long Beach. But I was the first celebrity to ever go to the Betty Ford Center. And they tell me, didn't quite know how to deal with me.
Mm.
And my peers had to pretend that it was just sort of Jane Schmo, and they were very awkward at first. And I didn't quite know what to do. Because I just wanted to disappear and be unobtrusive and kind of get mixed up in the woodwork. But within a day or 2 days, I realized that we were all in the same boat. we were there for one reason, to save our lives. And that we were all in trouble, and we all shared this common bond, and we all became such close friends. We leaned on each other and we helped each other.
Apart from the fact that you loved Richard Burton very dearly, why did you love Wales so much, which is where I come from?
Well, I know Pontry de Venn the best. Mm. Of course, mainly because of Richard's family.
Yes, yeah, where my sister lived too.
And I love the way it's sort of nestled in the mountains. And the people. Mm. The people are so wonderful.
Could they treat you as Elizabeth rather than Elizabeth Taylor, the movie star?
Oh, they do.
Yes.
When I come down there, they sing Welcome Home to the Valleys to me, and it makes me just weep. Mm. I feel they have made me feel Welsh, and actually I plan on being buried there.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
What, in Pontry de Venn?
Mm-hmm. Richard bought two plots years and years and years ago, 25 years ago. And since he's buried in Switzerland, I thought a part of him could be buried there, and that part of him that's in me can still be buried in Wales.
Well, I think that's absolutely wonderful. I mean, and that is because of feeling that sort of unity with him and Wales. Mm-hmm. Do you want to do that? Well, I'd like to wish you a very happy new life as the new Elizabeth Taylor.
Thank you. I'm having a great time.
Thank you very much indeed.
Everything that had started, and obesity was part of it, I was really in the pits.
Mm. But did you, when did you start to get into real danger with booze then? Because a lot of people drink and be merry, and nothing happens, does
it? I have
it?
Always been able to consume enormous amounts of booze and never get drunk.
Mm.
It would be when I'd go home and take my sleeping pills on top of the booze that I'd walk into walls.
Mm.
And that's when my children would have to pick me up off of the floor and put me into bed. And when I'd hear things like that, I was appalled.
Mm.
And riddled with such awful guilt that I'd done that to my children.
Mm.
I was devastated.
When you then went into Betty Ford, that was voluntary, obviously.
Mm.
And then were you able to, was it a group therapy you did?
Yes.
Yeah. It must have been very odd for people to do group therapy with you, because you were so
absolutely terrifying. And you listen, and it goes around the room. And finally I said to them, would you just leave me alone for a couple of hours? I have to make it my decision, because if it isn't my decision to go and do this, it won't last. It won't have any effect on me.
Did they come to see you then because of advice from, say, a doctor or something like that? I mean, did they do that on their own accord, or were they asked to do that?
No, they got together and just said, Mom's in trouble.
And then faced you with a lot of home truths.
Mm.
I mean, could you at that moment, with your addiction still strong, could you at that moment take it in and accept that they are probably telling you the truth about yourself?
Oh, I knew they were telling the truth.
Well, did you have a great character change, for instance?
Then and there?
Yes, no. But before, were you going through a very bad patch? Like, often alcohol...
Oh, I was
makes
at the bottom.
People, yeah, famous. It can't be everybody famous there, can they?
I was the first celebrity ever to have done it.
Yeah.
Except Betty Ford, of course, who did it at the Naval Center in Long Beach. But I was the first celebrity to ever go to the Betty Ford Center. And they tell me, didn't quite know how to deal with me.
Mm.
And my peers had to pretend that it was just sort of Jane Schmo, and they were very awkward at first, and I didn't quite know what to do, because I just wanted to disappear and be unobtrusive and kind of get mixed up in the woodwork. But within a day or 2 days, I realized that we were all in the same boat. We were there for one reason, to save our lives.
Mm.
And that we were all in trouble, and we all shared this common bond. And we all became such close friends.
Mm.
Then when I cleaned my inside act up, and I felt so wonderful, and energetic and good about myself, that's when I decided that I was wearing the wrong slipcover, and I wanted the exterior to match the interior.
Mm. You know, when you decided to go into Betty Ford, in your book you imply that it was partly pressure from your family. Is that right?
Family intervention.
Yeah, yeah. What does that mean? Do you mean they actually said to you,
they,
you should
they
do it?
They come and see you. It's called tough love. And they tell you things you've done, things they've seen, some of your behavior. And they preface it by saying, oh, I love you very much, but I have to tell you this, that. And the reason I'm telling you this is because I don't want you to die, and the way you're going, you will.
So kind of,
and
like,
it's astonishing. It's
But you seem to have been kind of steamrolling yourself into a mess, right? Because this is how you come over in the book. But that is from alcohol as well, and you had to go into the Betty Ford Hospital, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
That was presumably
not hospital. It's the centre.
Right. Now, that was because of alcoholism rather than obesity?
It had nothing to do with obesity.
No.
It had totally to do with addiction, alcohol and pills.
Mm.
And they advise you when you're there not to stop smoking, not to try and give up caffeine, not to diet, not to even think about it.
Mm.
You're there for one reason, and you concentrate on that 100%.
Mm.
And it's hard enough to get over that. You have to give it your all, and you go through a whole process of peeling layers of guck to get down to why did I become this mess.
Do you know why?
Oh, I learned there many things. I'm not going into it.
Yes, no. But were you going through a very bad patch, like often alcohol?
Oh, I was
makes
at the bottom.
Yeah.
Everything that had started, and obesity was part of it. I was really in the pits.
Mm. But did you, when did you start to get into real danger with booze then? Because a lot of people drink and be merry, and nothing happens, does
it? I have
it?
Always been able to consume enormous amounts of booze and never get drunk.
Mm.
It would be when I'd go home and take my sleeping pills on top of the booze that I'd walk into walls.
Mm.
And that's when my children would have to pick me up off of the floor and put me into bed. And when I'd hear things like that, I was appalled and riddled with such awful guilt that I'd done that to my children.
Mm.
I was devastated.
When you then went in
there? Many things. I'm not going into them.
Mm.
Then when I cleaned my inside act up, and I felt so wonderful and energetic and good about myself, that's when I decided that I was wearing the wrong slipcover. And I wanted the exterior to match the interior.
Mm. You know, when you decided to go into Betty Ford, in your book you imply that it was partly pressure from your family. Is that right?
Family intervention.
Yeah, yeah. What does that mean? Do you mean they actually said to you, you should do it?
They come and see you. It's called tough love. And they tell you things you've done, things they've seen, some of your behavior. And they preface it by saying, oh, I love you very much, but I have to tell you this, that. And the reason I'm telling you this is because I don't want you to die, and the way you're going, you will.
So kind of,
and
like,
it's astonishing. It's absolutely terrifying. And you listen, and it goes around the room. And finally I said to them, would you just leave me alone for a couple of hours? I have to make it my decision, because if it isn't mine, if it isn't my decision to go and do this, it won't last. It won't have any effect on me.
Did they come to see you then because of advice from, say, a doctor or something like that? I mean, did they do that on their own accord, or were they asked to do that?
No, they got together and just said, Mom's in trouble.
And then faced you with a lot of home truths.
Mm.
I mean, could you at that moment, with your addiction still strong, could you at that moment take it in and accept that they are probably telling you the truth about yourself?
Oh, I knew they were telling the truth.
Well, did you have a great character change, for instance? Were you
then in
Betty Ford, that was voluntary, obviously.
Mm.
And then were you able to was it a group therapy you did?
Yes.
Yeah. It must have been very odd for people to do group therapy with you, because you're so famous. It can't be everybody famous there, can they?
I was the first celebrity ever to have done it.
Yeah.
Except Betty Ford, of course, who did it at the Naval Center in Long Beach. But I was the first celebrity to ever go to the Betty Ford Center, and they really, they tell me, didn't quite know how to deal with me.
Mm.
And my peers had to pretend that it was just sort of Jane Schmo, and they were very awkward at first, and I didn't quite know what to do, because I just wanted to disappear and be unobtrusive and kind of get mixed up in the woodwork. But within a day or 2 days,
But you seem to have been kind of steamrolling yourself into a mess, right? Because this is how you come over in the book. But that is from alcohol as well, and you had to go into the Betty Ford Hospital, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
That was presumably...
Not hospital, it's the centre.
Right. Now, that was because of alcoholism rather than obesity?
It had nothing to do with obesity.
No.
It had totally to do with addiction, alcohol and pills.
Mm.
And they advise you when you're there not to stop smoking, not to try and give up caffeine, not to diet, not to even think about it.
Mm.
You're there for one reason, and you concentrate on that 100%.
Mm.
And it's hard enough to get over that. You have to give it your all, and you go through a whole process of peeling layers of guck to get down to... Why did I become this mess?
Do you know why?
Oh, I learned there.